Welcome, welcome, welcome to the NCAA edition of the Mad Dog Mike and Chyef Show, coming live to you from the Treat Studios right outside of downtown Charlotte. We're going to dedicate this whole show to the NCAA tournament that's we're right on the eve of. So excited about it. A lot of teams have a chance to win the whole thing. What you think, Mad Dog?
Oh yeah. This would probably be one of the craziest tournaments out there. I feel like any team can basically beat any team. But the crazy part is, you know, usually when the experts or the talking heads, as my man Chyef likes to say, when they predict, you know, a lot of sleepers, that's when the top teams usually prevail and win. Usually when there's a lot of people that say, oh, the top teams are going to win, that's usually when the sleepers.
Yeah.
So I feel like it's going to be an interesting tournament. I feel like there. And throughout the year, you know, there's been lower seed teams that's been beating the top ranked teams. So I feel like this is going to be an interesting tournament.
I definitely agree with you. I think, you know, just to piggyback on your point, I think this year had the most losses from top teams, like the number one team at the time, or top five they lost to unranked teams.
Mm-hmm.
I think that happened like 25 or 30 times this year or something like that, including the tournament. So a lot of parity in the NCAA as it is, which should make for a very good tournament. I'm really looking forward to it. You know, there were some teams that, you know, didn't make it, I believe.
Snubs.
Yeah. Louisville was one. There was a couple of other teams.
Oklahoma State.
Oklahoma State. Yeah, but again, like you were saying earlier, I mean, it was so much parity. I mean, if you didn't make it in this year, I mean, it was pretty much your fault,
mm-hmm.
you know, because, you know, when it gets down, I would say this year more than other years, when it gets down to those last, you know, five or six invitees or five or six seeds, you know, at the end of the, you know, between 60 and 68 of the teams that, you know, make it into the tournament. I mean, to me, you were just splitting hairs at this point. So,
right.
So, yeah, I'm really excited about the tournament, though.
Definitely. And before we get into the tournament, we're going to get right into it. But, you know, I never get a chance to ask you, how you feeling today, Chyef?
Oh, I'm good. I'm ready to go, man. You know, we coming off of a great ACC tournament, which, you know, Virginia did win. It's a lot of sports things going on. I mean, you know, we're in the legal tampering period for NFL free agency. I don't know exactly what that's supposed to mean, but
well, they're making some moves. Something's going on.
So, you know, we're not even going to get into that today, but we would definitely come back to that because, man, guys have been committing to sign left and right. They're not signing right now, right this moment. They can't do that until a couple of days from now, but it's a crazy great time for sports. So I'm doing good, man. Everything's good.
Good to hear, man. And you know, there's been for this year in the tournament, there's been a lot of scandal. We talked about that on our last podcast.
We did.
Check that out on our last podcast on YouTube. We're also on Anchor FM. Check us out on Facebook. We have a Facebook page, Mad Dog Mike and the Chyef.
We do.
Check us out. So there's been a lot of scandal with a lot of teams in the tournament this year. You kind of mentioned Virginia. They seem to be pretty much scandal-free.
Yeah.
For the most part.
Yeah, I haven't heard anything about the Cavaliers outside of, you know, their play, which, you know, they were the number one overall seed.
Right.
And they were actually the unanimous at the end of the season after all the tournaments and everything. They were the unanimous number one team in the country. So, you know, they've had a very good year. They ended 30-2.
Yes.
Had a very, very good year.
Yes. We're going to start in the South region. and talk a little bit about Virginia and see, you know, what's your predictions or what's our predictions on those guys.
Okay.
You know, for me, I know that and there's also some other teams I do want to discuss in that region. But let's start with the number one team, the number one overall in that in the NCAA, and then the number one overall in that region, that tournament with the Virginia Cavaliers. They did lose, and I know that I said in a previous podcast, you know, I was really high on them.
Yeah.
You know, I actually said I mentioned something about the Final Four. I am going to scale back on that a little bit. I have
okay,
to
okay.
with some recent things that's been going on and just kind of watching them a little bit closer. They lost their sixth man of the year, DeAndre Hunter, to an injury for the tournament. I think that's going to hurt them. That's another reason why I'm scaling them back because they also – they're already are not big scorers.
Yeah.
And he was one of their top scorers, I think top three or something like that, scorer on that team.
Yeah.
That's going to already hurt them with a shortened bench. So, you know, so I'm not going to – I'm going to scale back, like I said, with them getting to the Final Four. You know, are there teams out there that could trip them up? What's your thoughts, Chief?
Well, I think, yeah, definitely. I did not pick them to make it to the Final Four. That was even before the DeAndre Hunter news.
Right.
He is out for the rest of the season with a broken wrist. I'm assuming maybe it happened in practice because I don't think there was anything wrong with him in the ACC tournament.
No.
He played in the final game against North Carolina in which they won, and they won the ACC tournament. So I'm assuming either it was just some kind of accident that didn't have anything to do with basketball, or maybe he broke his wrist in practice or something of that nature. But that is a big hit to their Final Four and national title hopes. But again, I didn't have them making it to the Final Four. I actually had them losing in the round of 32 to Arizona. So I had beating the number 16 seed, which is the University of Maryland, Baltimore County.
Correct.
Then meeting Creighton in the round of 32.
Okay, yeah.
I apologize. Yeah, they meeting Creighton in the round of 32, them defeating Creighton, and then I have them losing to Arizona in the Sweet 16. So I was, you know, like you said, they're an elite defensive team. Elite defensive team. They have more scores than usual.
Right. Yes.
You know, they have a couple of guys, Cal guys, one of their big scores, 6'5" guard. But I just think that my thing with Virginia, again, even before Hunter got hurt, was you have to prove it to me. Since Tony Bennett has been coach, I mean, they've had some great regular seasons, and they've been in the mix in the ACC pretty much since he's been the coach there. Maybe he's had one or two maybe subpar seasons. But every time they get into the tournament, you know, they remind me of Kansas, which we'll talk about Kansas later too. Mm-hmm. You know, they get a couple of wins, and then they run up against someone – and, you know, they get – usually it's an early exit.
Yeah, I 100% do agree with you on this one. I actually did have them in the Sweet 16 losing to Arizona also.
Oh, okay.
Even before the injury.
Oh, okay.
You know, it was just some things, especially there's just with Virginia and, you know, I got to give you props on your analyst before.
Appreciate that.
They keep the problem is they keep games close, too close at times. Like what I feel like they could have blew the Tar Heels out.
Yeah.
In the ACC championship. But they kept the game close, and there's times where they could have had some fast break points. And they just slow it. They'll stop.
Yeah.
And they'll just slow it down. So, yeah, I got them getting as far as the Sweet 16. I feel like they will lose to Arizona, which I feel like Arizona is definitely a team to be reckoned with.
Definitely.
I feel like they are going to come out the South. I have them in the Final Four. You know, they've been playing well since the beginning of the year, and they finished strong. And I with Arizona, I'm excited to see that Arizona-Kentucky war in that second round of that region.
Oh yeah, that should be a really good game.
Yeah, I feel that's going to be probably one of the best games in the tournament. But yeah, I really like just to switch gears since we're talking about Arizona. I really like them. DeAndre Ayton is, I feel like, one of the best, if not the best players. Definitely the best big man in the country. Arizona is probably the most talented team in the country. And I feel like they have a lot to prove with that scandal and everything that has been recently going on with them.
Well, I do think that they're playing with a chip on their shoulder because, you know, as we talked about, as you alluded to earlier in the last podcast, you know, it's still a lot of confusion as to whether the story that ESPN came out with in regards to Sean Miller, who's their coach, and DeAndre Ayton, whether or not, you know, he was trying to facilitate some type of payment to DeAndre Ayton's family. That's still kind of up in the air. And you can kind of tell that DeAndre Ayton is, and the team itself, is playing with a chip on their shoulder. So yeah, that should be a great game. Kentucky has actually been kind of up and down this season, mm-hmm. and but that should be a good game. But I do just want to point out of course, Arizona did win the Pac-12 championship. The last two games that the you know, Arizona won the semifinal and the final. The semifinal, DeAndre Ayton had 32 points and 12 rebounds.
Yeah.
The final, he had 32 points and 18 rebounds. So yeah, they're definitely going to be a force to reckon with. And just to jump back in with what I was saying about Kentucky, to be honest with you, I wasn't really sure about Kentucky. I wasn't even really sure if they are going to get past Davidson. Because they have a lot of talent, but they've been up and down this year. They went out of the top 25 this year. I think it was the first time in like 5 or 6 years they were out of the top 25. I gave them, I went on ahead with them. I think maybe their talent and athleticism at the end of the day might get them past Davidson.
Right.
But, Alonzo Trier, who is Arizona's point guard, and DeAndre Ayton, I just think at the end of the day, they're going to be too much for Kentucky. Now, we both kind of on the Arizona bandwagon here for this South region, but is there a team outside of Arizona that you might think can, you know, slip past Arizona and maybe possibly make it to the Final Four?
I'm going with. Nah.
Okay.
I think Arizona, I mean, that is for Virginia, that's a tough region, you know. Say, you know, I mean, you got Tennessee out there who is a really solid team. But I do really like, you got Cincinnati too, who's a really solid team. I do have Cincinnati playing Arizona in the Elite Eight with Arizona beating them.
Oh, okay.
But I really like that Arizona team. I don't think that that there's anybody out there with the talent that can really beat them. Who I do really like, at least for a sleeper, I like that Loyola Chicago team, man.
Oh, okay.
Ooh,
okay.
I really like those guys. I feel like you know, they can make some noise.
Okay.
At least do a couple upsets.
Okay.
As a dark horse team in that tournament.
It's definitely possible. I mean, I have Miami winning that first round game, but I mean, I'm not, you know, if Miami were to lose, I mean, that wouldn't be it, you know, that wouldn't be totally surprising to me. But I do actually have a dark horse that could pop. I mean, I'm going with Arizona to the Final Four.
Yeah.
But it would not surprise me to see Texas come out of the South region.
You like Texas?
I like Texas. I like Texas. They have Mo Bamba, which is another, you know, he's a center for Texas. He's, you know, one of those elite freshmen as well. And the reason why I'll give you, I like him. I think he's a good reason. But the main reason I like Texas is because they're coached by Shaka Smart. And yeah, you have to remember
respect,
that.
Respect.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And, you know, Shaka Smart took a VCU team that's much less talented than the team he has right now of Texas, you know, to the Sweet 16. I believe he may have taken a VCU team to the Elite Eight. So I like possibly Texas as a dark horse coming out of this region. But I also have – I actually have Arizona defeating Texas to go to the Final Four out of this region.
Wonderful. Okay. I hear you. I hear you. So it seems like we're pretty unanimous on our Arizona pick. Just a couple differences on a couple games maybe here and there. But it seems like Arizona is one of our both of our favorites.
Yeah, it definitely looks like that. But, you know, again, you know, with these young teams, even, you know, with DeAndre Ayton, you know, being a freshman, I mean, you just kind of never know. I mean, I'm a rock with them, but, I mean, you never know. If they don't make it, again, I won't be surprised. I mean, they lost a couple of games. They lost to NC State early in the season. So, that's one of the things that I'm so excited about this tournament. I mean, I really feel like anything can happen.
Right. And again, mark my words, Loyola, Chicago, the Ramblers. Now, don't get me wrong. Miami is a tough matchup. Even Tennessee is a tough matchup. But my dark horse and a sleeper alert, if there was want to be one in this region, watch out for that Loyola, Chicago team.
But, definitely.
But definitely. But moving on, let's move over to the East region where we have the number two overall. They were number one for most of the season. Very consistent. The Villanova Wildcats leads the top in that region over there in the East. You know, they are solid, man. They're solid around. You know, they have pretty much everything you're looking for in a title pick team. Pretty much it starts with their guard, Brunson, Jalen Brunson. He's already been to the national championship.
He has.
You know, he might even be the college player of the year. He's got Bridges over there, his co-star, the redshirt junior. Who's basically proved himself and worked himself into possibly an NBA lottery pick.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, those guys over there, they're just really deep. I mean, you can keep going. You got Amari Spellman, their center, who's actually their leading three-point shooter. Shooting 44% from the field.
Wow.
So he's a great rebounder. And, you know, he's definitely a difference maker around the rim. You got the guards. You got other guards like Phil Booth and I believe it was Dante DiVincenzo.
DiVincenzo. Yeah.
You know,
no, he's a really good player.
Right, right. Yeah. They also can provide scoring supplement for if someone's having an off night. That the coach, I think it all starts with the coach, Jay Wright.
Yeah.
You know, they've been there before.
He has. Yeah, definitely,
you know,
elite.
Two years ago. And, you know, he's got the players. And they are basically like the typical, you know, powerhouse team that one and done type team, like Duke and, you know, Kentucky, those type of teams that have those one and done type players. So, you know, I definitely. Villanova's my favorite. I'm going to say it straight up. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. I don't know, but I'm really excited about Villanova, that team to take it all away, to be honest with you. You know, do you feel like there's some teams out there that could possibly trip them up?
Well, I definitely agree with you. I mean, I think at the end of the day, Villanova comes out of this region. You know, to be honest with you, it seems like the easiest road. There are some teams that may be able to give them some you know, may be able to give them some problems. You know, Purdue is in this region or this bracket, this portion of the bracket. Arkansas, you know, they play a unique style with the press and the up and down play. So they may be able to give them some problems. Texas Tech has been pretty good this year as well. But all in all, to be honest with you, out of all three of the region, I mean, all four of the regions, I believe this, you know, this Villanova in this region may have the easiest route. I have them defeating Texas Tech in the Elite Eight to go to the Final Four.
Final Four. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Villanova defeating Texas Tech to make it into the Final Four. There's some pretty good teams here. Even UCLA, they're actually playing in the first four. You know, they were one of the last teams to get in, but they have enough players to make some noise as well. Maybe get a couple get a couple of victories and bust the bracket. So
UCLA is playing right now. Actually, St. Bonaventure.
Oh, okay, okay. Yeah. They have I believe it's Jalen Holiday, who is Drew Holiday's younger brother.
Yeah,
playing he's a very good player. And again, Arkansas, you know, they have a very unique style of play. They, you know, they press and they like to get the ball up and down the court. Now, Villanova does have very good guards, so that might not affect them like it may affect other teams. But again, I really don't see too much resistance coming out of this region. I think Villanova may make it to the Final Four fairly easily. But if they come up against any resistance, I would say that it would probably come from either, you know, Texas Tech or Arkansas, one of those teams.
No, again, I think we've been looking off of each other's brackets, man, cheating and all.
Each other.
No, again, I got to agree with you on this. You know, there's two teams I do want to focus on out of this region. I agree. There's really no one out there in this region that's that I feel can really give Villanova any competition besides maybe possibly Texas Tech, which I also do have them going to the Elite Eight, meeting up with Villanova beating them, obviously advancing to the Final Four, as my man Chief said. But I do want to focus on I do want to talk about Texas Tech, I also want to, you know, if there is a dark horse or kind of a sleeper, I'm not too high on them, but if I'm going to go with someone in this region, I would say look out for Wichita State.
Okay. Okay.
You know, I watched them play. I watched them play Houston. I watched them play Cincinnati. They lost both of those games. But I did, you know, I did see a little bit enough to show that they could make some noise and have some, you know, I believe I have them going to the Sweet 16. Wichita State Sweet 16 losing to Villanova. I have them losing to Villanova also in the Sweet 16.
Okay.
So, you know, I would say watch out for them. You know, I feel like they also have a chip on their shoulder after losing, you know, in the conference tournament to Houston.
They did.
Yeah. You know, Coach Greg Marshall, he's a great coach.
Yeah.
He keeps that team competing at a high level. And they have a lot of good guards. Landry Shemet, is a really good, decent guard. He's good with the deep ball.
Okay.
And they, you know, they have a really a well-balanced team. As far as Texas Tech, you know, one name I'm going to say is Keenan Evans.
Yes, definitely. Keenan Evans is
he's definitely a difference maker. I mean, he's probably one of the if there's truly a most valuable player for a team.
Yeah,
I feel like he's it. You know, I know he's had some late season injuries,
mm-hmm.
Which kind of hindered him a little bit. But you know, he's a threat for any team in a tournament. You know, sometimes all you need is that one player to make a difference. Like I said, I don't see them beating Villanova, but I do see them getting to the Elite Eight. And, you know, they have a top 20 defense. So in the tournament also, you know, defense is very important.
It is very important. You know, as they say, offense wins games, defense wins championships. So defense is very important. Keenan Evans, he's kind of their do-everything guy for Texas Tech, and he is a great player. So, I mean, I can definitely see him, you know, lifting them, you know, to a matchup with Villanova. And again, as I said earlier, I mean, any of these matchups can be flip-flopped. You know, your choice of dark horse or sleeper with Wichita State, I mean, I have them losing to West Virginia in the round of 32, but
that is definitely possible.
Yeah. But what you said is possible as well. I mean, they could definitely beat West Virginia. You know, West Virginia is a pretty good team, but, you know, I would, maybe West Virginia is maybe a level, you know, a level and a half better than Wichita State, but I mean, right. They can, you know, Wichita State could, upset them or beat them in a matchup, you know. So, again, a lot of these teams here, the way I look at this East region is it's kind of Villanova and everyone else.
Right.
Obviously, if Villanova has a bad game or they don't show up for a game, you know, anyone can be beat on any day. And in this tournament set up where it's one and done, you know, if you have a bad night, and you can't, you know, fight through it and get the victory, then, you know, you'll be going home. But, you know, I see Villanova definitely coming out of this region. You know, I definitely agree with your possible sleeper pick of Wichita State. If Keenan Evans comes to play, maybe Texas Tech can give them some problems. But I do see Villanova coming out of this region. As I said, I see them defeating Texas Tech to make it to the Final Four.
I will say this about that Texas Tech. The first round game, watch out for Stephen F. Austin. If they could possibly beat Texas Tech, they're very solid. So, you know, just watch out for them just in case, Texas Tech can't get out of that first round against Stephen F. Austin. So, that will change things. But if they do, I feel like if they do beat Stephen F. Austin, I feel like, you know, they can definitely beat. I have UCLA if they win tonight, making it to the second round and beating those guys. And I actually have them, Texas Tech, if they get past, and I'm going to say if they get past Stephen F. Austin, I have them actually beating Purdue in the Elite Eight to take them to, I'm sorry, Sweet 16.
Okay.
To take them to the Elite Eight against Virginia, Villanova.
Okay. So let me just make it clear though, Mad Dog. So you're putting Texas Tech on upset alert, just, you know, because that's a 3-14 matchup.
Exactly.
So,
I am.
Okay.
But,
okay.
You know, if they can beat Stephen F. Austin, if they don't get upset in the first round, I think that they can move forward.
Okay. Well, I mean, your bracket is as good as mine. I mean, these things are so crazy, you know, it's one of the things that is so entertaining about this tournament is it's so many teams. It's so many different ways this tournament can turn with victories and losses. So I definitely see that. I mean, I definitely see that as a possibility. Like I said, it looks like, you know, we both have Villanova coming out of this region, but, you know, we'll just have to see how everything plays out as far as the East region is concerned.
Yes. It's exciting times around here. Right
it
now.
Is.
Exciting
it
times
is.
Around here right now. But, we're going to continue with our portion of the Song of the Week. Song of the Week is brought to you by Treats Popcorn. Treats Popcorn has over 21 flavors of popcorn. They have the best hot dogs in Fort Mill, South Carolina. That's a nice area, Fort Mill.
It is.
They provide the Nathan's hot dog. What'd you say? The Nathan hot dog?
And, yeah, the Nathan's hot dogs. The hot dogs they use in 4th of July, the hot dog eating contest.
Yes, sir. I like Nathan's. They also have cotton candy. Candy apples and the funnel cakes on Fridays and Saturdays. Man, those funnel cakes.
You got to go check those funnel cakes out. Not only does he just have the regular funnel cakes with the powdered sugar, but, I mean, he puts strawberries, cherries. I mean, you can basically get whatever type of topping on the funnel cake that you like. So you definitely have to check them out on Friday and Saturday, you know, and go and check out those funnel cakes along with all the other treats that you can get at Treats.
Okay. Hook it up, Patrick. Hook it up. So again, Treats Popcorn will be sponsoring or is sponsoring our Song of the Day. Our Song of the Day, of course, it's got to be, you know, it's tournament time. It's one and done. It's survival of the fittest. So it's only fitting that we bring to you Survival of the Fittest by Mobb Deep. Only the strong survive.
Yeah. Sending this one out to my man Killer B. No doubt, indeed. You know what I'm saying? There's a war going on outside, no man is safe from. You could run, but you can't hide forever from these streets that we done took. You walking with your head down, scared to look. You shook, cause ain't no such things as halfway crooks. They never around when the beef cooks. In my part of town, it's similar to Vietnam. Now we all grown up and old and beyond the cops' control. They better have the riot gear ready, trying to back me and get rock steady. Bada, one double, I touch you and leave you with not much to go home with. My skin is thick, cause I'll be up in the mix of action. If I'm not at home, puffin' live, relaxing. New York got it depressed, so I wear a slug proof underneath my guest. God bless my soul before I put my foot down and begin to stroll into the drama I built. And all unfinished beef, you will soon be put us together. It's like mixing vodka and milk. I'm going out blasting, taking my enemies with me. And if not, they scar, so they will never forget me. Lord, forgive me. The Hennessy got me not knowing how to act. I'm falling and I can't turn back. Or maybe it's the words from my man Killer Black that I can't say, so what's left an untold fact. Until my death, my goal's to stay alive. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive.
Yo, we live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive.
I'm trapped in between two worlds trying to make dough. You know when the dough get low, the jewels go. But never that, as long as fiends smoke, I'll be on the block hustling, counting my stacks, no doubt. Watching my back and proceed with caution. 5-0's lurking, no time to get lost in. The system brothers using fake names to get out quick. My brother did it and got back with two. I live with one squads, hit the block hard. Ask my man Trent when he got back, they messed me up, God. But things happen for a reason. You find out who's your true peoples when you're up north bleeding. You can't find a shorty to troop your bed with you. Hit with a 2-4, it's difficult. While on the streets, I try to maintain. Tight grip, my Lucas shorties like to run game. Some brothers like to trick, but I ain't on that trickin' tip. I'm like a safer dose who I can bit with. Pushing the Lex, now I'm set, ready to jet. No matter how much loot I get, I'm staying in the projects forever. Jake's on the blocks, we out clever. In beef, we never separate, roll together. When worst come to worst, my peoples come first. Try to react and world is born, get your feelings hurt. My crew's all about loot, forget looking cute. Not strictly temples, an army certified suits. Puffin' nails, lay back, enjoy the smell. In the bridge, dumping eyes, it ain't hard to tell. You better realize.
We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. We live in this till the day that we die. Survival of the fit, only the strong survive.
Survival of the fittest, only the strong survive. Mobb Deep, we had to take you up top for the song of the week.
Ah, yeah.
Mobb Deep. Oh, no, go ahead.
That's my joint, Mobb Deep. Boy, they get me hyped. Yeah.
Yeah, so we definitely, you know, we try, you know, what we talked about the song of the week, we doing early 90s and 2010, but we also try to hit hip hop from different parts of the country within that time period as well. So we felt it was time to take it up top with Mobb Deep, Survival of the Fittest. As Mad Dog said, you know, that's basically the motto of this tournament that we're talking about. The NC State run in the 80s, the early 80s, survive in advance. Survival of the fittest. Only the strong survive. Mobb Deep. So that's the song of the week again, sponsored by Treats Popcorn. Please go go check Patrick out in Fort Mill at Treats Popcorn. And we're going to move on with this. We're going to move on to the Midwest region where Kansas is the number one seed and Duke is the number two seed. And I would say, my opinion, Mad Dog, I think this may be the toughest region.
Yes.
It's loaded. It's loaded. Kansas, Duke, Michigan State, all in the same region. So it's tough. It's tough. I'll go ahead and say I definitely do not have Kansas coming out of this region. Kansas kind of falls in the same category with me as Virginia. Like, you have to show me something.
Right.
You know, they did win the one championship a few years ago now. I believe it was in the mid-2000s. But outside of that, they usually get into the tournament and, you know, they win a couple of games and then they get knocked out. And it's usually by a team that they shouldn't lose to.
Yes.
And with all these other teams in the bracket, I just don't see them making it out. I mean, actually, to be honest with you, I have them losing to North Carolina State in the round of 32.
Ooh, yeah. I like it.
Yeah, I mean, and the reason I have that is because Kansas has the propensity to lose those type of games. And actually, you know, NC State, they beat Arizona in a early year tournament. They beat UNC at home this year. And they beat Duke. So NC State this year, even though they've been somewhat inconsistent as a whole, over the whole of the season, they tend to get up for these big games. And
yeah.
I think they're going to be ready for Kansas. And, you know, Kansas is known to go out early. That's what they do for the most part. So I'm taking NC State over Kansas in the round of 32.
Oh, man, we're really close. And, again, I appreciate your analysts, Chief. We're pretty much on the same page. I will take Kansas over NC State in the, 32?
The round of 32.
Round of 32. I think NC State is going to have a tough matchup against Seton Hall. But I could really see NC State winning that game. I'm actually going to, let me stick on NC State real quick. I think if they can beat Kansas, I think they can make some noise.
Okay.
I think they've beaten, strong. They've beaten Carolina. They've beaten Duke. They've beaten Arizona, Clemson, all these teams, and I really like their point guard, Johnson. I think I was saying something in a previous podcast about when they played. I watched when they played Carolina. Hey, man, he was giving Barry the business, man.
Oh, yeah. He has ice in his veins.
Yeah.
He's definitely for real. They have a nice team. Coach Kevin Keats. He put a good team together. Al Freeman is a part of that team. Torin Dorn. He basically has Torin Dorn at 6'5" playing power forward.
Right.
In a small lineup, a four guard lineup, but that seems to work for them. Braxton Beverly. They have a good mix of big guys, and their guards can really knock down the three.
Right, right. Yes, definitely. I want to give, as my man Chief again, we don't disagree too much for some reason. I know some people like to banter and go back and forth, but we're seeing eye to eye on a lot of these things. I do want to give shout outs to to Coach Kevin Keats for really putting this team together in his first year.
Oh, definitely. I mean, it fabulous job.
Right.
Fabulous job. He basically pieced his team together. Within the past couple of years, there have been a lot of guys to transfer out of the program. A couple of guys went to the NBA. And he was able to get these guys in here. You know, Beverly, he was able to get the transfer over from Ohio State. Mm-hmm. Al Freeman came from Baylor. Johnson was already there. But he's been able to get these guys to buy in to a style of play. And no one thought that they would be in this position this early. So, I mean, definitely a great coaching job. I actually have, like you said, if they can get past Kansas, they can make some noise. I actually have them losing to Michigan State in the Elite Eight. And then Michigan State moving on to the Final Four. So I feel like they're going to get past that game with Kansas, and I really feel like they're going to make a deep run in this tournament.
Two teams I want to focus on, actually three. Duke's one of them, but I'll get to Duke in a second. You did mention Michigan State, and I want to get to them in a second, but I do want to give a sleeper. I love my sleepers. Okay. A dark horse in this region. I have to go with New Mexico State, baby.
Okay.
I'm really high on this team, man. New Mexico State out there is balling. I actually have them beating Kansas in the Elite Eight.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yes. I have them beating Kansas in the Elite Eight and actually making it, having them beating Kansas in the Sweet 16, excuse me. So I have Kansas beating NC State in the second round, 32, and I have New Mexico State beating Kansas in the Sweet 16. This is my spoiler upset of the week.
Okay.
New Mexico State. Okay. I mean, if you're going to root for a team as a sleeper, I feel like the New Mexico State Aggies is that team. They check off all the criteria for a Cinderella team, a feel-good story. They are the number 12 seed. You know, number 12 seeds are really, really upset-type specialist teams from past history.
It is.
They come from a one big conference, the WAC. They lost their head coach a year ago, and this is a great redemption story for their current coach. They have a 6'5", Charles Barkley-type rebounding beast out there in Jamario Jones.
I believe like five games with 20 plus rebounds this year or something like that?
Yeah, this dude is averaging 13.2. He's 6'5 now, averaging 13.2 rebounds a game, which I believe is the second most in the NCAA.
That's phenomenal.
He's shooting 50% from the floor. He's averaged 11 points, 3.1 rebounds. And they have the top 10. They are the 10th best defensive unit in the league. Which is they basically only allow 64 points a game. I feel like they are a very dangerous team.
Well, no. I mean, there is something to be said. They, got very hot in their conference tournament. Them along with also another team in a bracket we haven't gotten to yet, Houston.
Mm-hmm.
Along with Houston, New Mexico State, they got very hot in their tournament. And there is something said, something to be said for that. I actually have them losing to Clemson in that initial game, but I can see. But I mean, I can see them beating Clemson. I mean, Clemson has had some injuries, but and I know New Mexico State is a good team, but I'm just kind of going off of how Clemson performed in the ACC tournament. They actually performed pretty well.
Here's my thing with Clemson, though. I feel like they peaked. I feel like we've seen the best that they can play for the year. So I feel like they've peaked, and I definitely see New Mexico State taking those boys out for a upset special. Michigan State, real quick. Michigan State, I don't see why they also can't contend for a title. I feel like they're very underseeded. I didn't mean to cut you off. I didn't mean to.
Go right ahead.
You know, they have the overall experience and the talent. Miles Bridges, as we mentioned before.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, the top, one of the top players in the league.
In the country, definitely.
In the country, excuse me. And him and Jaren Jackson, they're definitely future NBA stars. Tom H to the Izzo. he is an experienced coach. He plays a big factor on why I like Michigan State. I definitely have them getting to the Final Four. And I think that they have their best ball yet to play. I do have them, though, however, losing to Villanova in the Final Four.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, you know, speaking of Michigan State, I actually have Michigan State in the championship game.
Yeah. I can see it.
Yeah, yeah. I have, you know, Duke has been so up and down this year. I have them meeting Duke in the Sweet 16, Michigan State, that is. And I have Michigan State defeating Duke to move on to the Elite Eight. So, but yeah, Michigan State, they are definitely a strong team. Like you said, Miles Bridges, one of the top players in the country. I mean, they do have that experience. I mean, just a wealth of tournament experience with their coach, Tom Izzo. So, yeah, I have Michigan State going to the championship game. I have them defeating NC State in the Elite Eight to go to, you know, to move to the Final Four. And then I have them defeating Villanova to move to the championship game. So that's what I have on my end. But I think the teams in this region are definitely going to beat up on each other. But I think at the end of the day, you know, Michigan State is the team with the most talent there. Like I was saying about NC State, they, you know, they have been able to beat teams that are quote unquote better than them or ranked higher than them this year. But I think when they get to that game with Michigan State in the Elite Eight, I think Michigan State might just be a little bit too much for them.
No, I agree. You know, I do see, you know, Michigan State beating Duke. I have Duke going all the way to the Sweet 16, losing to Michigan State in the Elite Eight. So, you know, Duke, you know, I feel like they, I mean, they do have a lot of talent, but, you know, we've seen them have a lot of, you know, moments. They probably have, you know, the one of the most weapons.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
you know, in all tournament. But, you know, they're young talent. They have those freshman moments. And sometimes
they
have those freshman moments from some of their seniors. You know, and real quick, just to, you know, I have to do it, man, because, you know, I, and we kind of talked about it a little off air, man. Grayson Allen, man.
Oh, man.
If he does, if he has a, if there's a senior that has freshman moments, he's the prime example of one of those guys. I mean, you know, we talked about it in the previous podcast where that first game against North Carolina where he turned the ball over late. And then he comes around and plays them at home, and he has an awesome game. He does everything that you can ask for out of a senior leader. He just led the team. But then what does he do? What does he do?
Neutral site, ACC tournament.
In the ACC tournament against the same North Carolina Tar Heels that couple days before – he had a great game. He goes and he just makes two. Bonehead. I don't even. That's the only word I can think of. Just two turnovers that just loses the game for them, man. So he's going to be, when the lights are on and that type of thing, I don't see how he's just going to flake, man. So I don't see how they can really do anything if they get that far to Michigan State.
Well, I think. Duke is, if not the most talented, one of the most talented teams in the country. I think what Coach K has to do is, in order for them to win, if it's close at the end of the game, like, he needs to take the ball out of Grayson Allen's hands.
Yeah.
He shouldn't be the decision maker. Now, if you want to run him off screens and set him a play to catch and shoot, or set him up, you know, set him up a play to get the ball and maybe drive the ball to the basket, give him a directive.
No, don't drive. No, just catch and shoot.
But I mean, some guys, and I know, you know, I'm not a Duke fan, but I mean, I'm just giving you what I see here. I'm being objective. I mean, some guys are not cut out to make those type of decisions at the end of the game. You know, like everybody can't be Michael Jordan. You know what I'm saying? Or and I know Michael Jordan is probably an extreme example, but some guys are just not cut out to make those decisions. Like he's shown to me time and time again that like Coach K has put the ball in his hands at the end of the game, and like he's either turned the ball over, made a bad decision. Like you were talking about in the Carolina game, the last game that they lost in the ACC tournament, he draws a charge. And then less than a minute later, you know, to close out the game, they run a play for him to try to get a three. And he like does some kind of pump fake to try to get Luke May up in the air. And like he just ends up shooting the air ball. I don't know if his nerves or like I don't know if the moment is too big for him, but he doesn't make good decisions with the ball at the end of the game. I know Coach K may not want to trust the freshman Duval or Gary Trent with the ball at the end of the game, but I mean I'm thinking
I trust Trent over.
That, you know, I think that, you know, those guys may be a better option because I feel like Grayson Allen has already pretty much showed you what he's going to do if you try to put the game in his hands at the end. So you have Michigan State coming out of the Midwest,
yep.
But then being defeated by Villanova. So you have Villanova in the championship.
Right. But, you know, like you said, Michigan State has the talent to beat Villanova. I'm just going with Nova.
No. Like I said earlier, I mean, and that's what's so great, especially this year in the tournament. There's no dominant team. So, I mean, your word, I mean, what you think is as good as what I think. I mean, all of these things can be flip-flopped and no one could, you know, no one would be like, oh my God, what happened? So, moving on to the last region here is the West region that's led by the number one seed, Xavier, and the number two seed.
Really, bro?
Really?
Really.
The number one seed is Xavier. The number two seed is North Carolina, and the number three seed is Michigan. I have North Carolina coming out of this region. I mean, hey, you know, I'm looking at the bracket. I'm like, I don't really see anybody that, you know, Xavier, they kind of tripped up in the Big East tournament. Michigan is pretty good, but my thing with North Carolina is Joel Berry, Theo Pinson, these guys, they've been to two Final Fours. Luke May has been to one Final Four and one. I mean, in this type of scenario with the one and done, like they've basically seen almost every basketball scenario, whether it be tournament or regular season, that you can have. I just think that experience is invaluable. And I mean, with these, there's no team in this bracket that's head and shoulders, you know, more talented than they are. So I feel like their experience will carry them much further than some of these other teams in this bracket, because basically they're either more talented or they're at the same level of talent of the other higher seeded teams in this bracket.
I got to disagree with you, son. No, well, hold on. Before I disagree, I will say, yes, they have probably one of the most experienced teams in the tournament. And, you know, that could definitely favor them. You know, this is not a highly talented bracket. So, you know, I'm not going to disagree with you 100%. But before, you know, I get to North Carolina, and there's a team I do want to talk about,
okay,
and which is kind of related to the North Carolina Tar Heels not making it all the way.
Okay.
Is Missouri. Missouri with Michael Porter Jr. coming back, baby. This is a sleeper team for me, a sleeper team, the AC Missouri. They are, you know, they are very dangerous. I know they had a lot of up and downs, you know, without Porter, You know, I know he was kind of rusty a little bit in the SEC tournament. But, you know, I feel like, you know, if they can get past the first round, which is
Florida State,
which they will, then I have them upsetting Xavier in the second round. I have them upsetting Gonzaga in the Elite, in the Sweet 16, excuse me. And I, but I do have them losing, to Michigan, which is who I really want to get to. Michigan, I feel like that Michigan team can beat Carolina. I have Carolina making it to the Sweet 16. I feel like you know, Providence could be a tough matchup for them. You know, I feel like they will beat Providence, but I really like Michigan. I'm gonna be honest with you. I feel like I see a Michigan-Missouri Elite Eight. You know, I know Michigan has had a layoff, but they won the Big Ten. They're very hot coming in right now. They're 28-7, winners of 9 consecutive games. They seem to have perfected the peaking in March magic over the last 2 years, winning back-to-back Big Ten titles. But what's really interesting is that long break that they had. I believe they had pretty much a week layover. So if, again, you know, if that layover does not hinder them from losing in the first round to Montana, I feel like they can make it all the way to the Final Four. Against Arizona, and I feel like they can upset North Carolina in the Sweet 16.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, I'll just have to agree to disagree because, I mean, you mentioned peaking in March, but there's one team there that really has peaked in March because they've been in the national championship game the last 2 years. So I would kind of say that would be a little more peaking than winning the conference tournament, but I understand. I got you, but you know, Porter, Missouri, Providence, Michigan. I mean, Carolina's seen all of it. I mean, they played Duke twice. Mm-hmm. They played Virginia twice mm-hmm. this year. And there's, you know, it's possible that they get snuck up on, but I don't, even with Missouri and Porter, like none of these teams really have the talent to just step on the court and beat North Carolina.
So you're telling me Michigan does not have national championship potential? You're telling me Michigan does not have is not as talented or more talented than North Carolina and the Tar Heels? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Yeah, wow. I don't even know if Michigan gets past the winner of Houston and San Diego State.
No, we'll give you that. I mean, Houston is a good team. You know, Houston is solid. You know, Rob Gray out there is a very underrated point guard. You know, they, you know, lost to Cincinnati in that division by, you know, just a bonehead play at the end of the game. So, you know, that is a possibility. That is a possibility that they get upset by Houston. I'm not, you know, putting anything past Houston. But, you know,
Well, no.
I guess the Tar Heels are maybe just an underdog for me.
I respect. I just want to make it clear. No, I respect your opinion. I really do. But like, I watched their run. I mean, like you talked about earlier in the podcast. I mean, they basically lost a national championship on a Hail Mary shot 2 years ago. Then, I mean, they gutted out a win against Gonzaga last year. I mean, they're, you know, the seniors. And the upperclassmen on this team, like I said, have seen, you know, every possible situation. I'm not saying that they cannot lose because, I mean, any one of these teams can lose at any time. It's a one-and-done tournament. But, I mean, I mean, Michigan's a good team. Don't get me wrong. Providence is good as well. But I really believe that those guys on that North Carolina team, that they want to win back-to-back. I think the last team that won back-to-back was Duke, 91-92. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, this field, we talked about it earlier, it's so watered down. There's no dominant team. And the teams with the most talent, the talent are young guys. They're freshmen. So you never really know what you're going to get out of them from game to game. I mean, if there is going to be a team that repeats, I would think that it would be a team that would be set up kind of like Carolina is, with a good mix of young guys and then guys that, I mean, have been deep in the tournament year after year after year. I mean, there's really no replacement for that experience.
Right. And let me give my respect to the Tar Heels. You know, I'm not, you know, I feel like they will get past Providence. I'm not saying Providence won't beat them. You know, and they do have a lot of to play for. I'm not going to compare them to that Duke team with Leitner and all them boys, but I will say this: Roy Williams, he doesn't lose first round games. You know, he is, you know, and they excel during tournament time, no doubt, without a doubt. They're top five scorers. They're all veterans. They have a veteran team. You know, they've been to the championship, you know, the last 2 years. And you know, they know what to expect in the tournament. This is not their first run in the tournament. You know, they got Luke May, who's averaging 17.2 points a game. They got Joel Barry,
who's 17 and 10.
Excuse me. Joel Barry, who's averaging 17 points a game. So those guys are going to get the most attention. So I'm definitely going to go, you know, with, if there is a sleeper player on that team, again, I got to go to my man, the underrated Theo Pinson, man. I'm going to go with him, man. He's extremely underrated. He's averaging 10 points, 16 boards, and 4 assists, almost 5 assists a game. You know, if he's not knocking down threes, you know, he's on the ground. He's playing down low. He's running the point.
Yeah,
he's doing everything that they ask him for. So, you know, I'm not going to get too down on him.
Oh, no.
But I just got a feeling Michigan, if that Michigan North Carolina matchup, if Michigan gets that far, then I just feel like, you know, and we've seen it again. I've said it before, you know, we in one of the early podcasts again with Duke, with that talent against them, with that experience. And I know, you know, Michigan is kind of like that. They have that young talented group. So, you know, I can see them beating Michigan, but I don't really see them definitely not getting to the Final Four.
Well, no, I mean, and I definitely respect that. I do. I have North Carolina defeating Ohio State in the Elite Eight to go to the Final Four. And again, I'll just make one more point with North Carolina. They, you know, they lost to Virginia in the ACC championship game. That was their fourth game in 4 days. But they were able to win 3 games in 3 days with, you know, definitely 2 of their 3 best players, Luke May and Joel Berry. Neither one of them really had a good tournament.
Yeah.
So, you know, like you were saying earlier, and like I was saying, there, you know, this is Joel Berry's last run. This is Theo Pinson's last run. I really feel like they're going to step their games up. I have them coming out of the West region. I have them defeating Arizona in the Final Four, and I have them defeating Michigan State in the national championship game.
You have them beating Arizona and Michigan State?
Yeah, why not?
Of course, because you're, of course. That's your team. That's your team.
I mean,
That's a hard game right there. That's a hard game, bro.
I mean, they played Bagley twice. Bagley, you know, Ayton may be a little bit better than Bagley, but they're in the same stratosphere. Now, there's not a lot of, I mean, people may have their preferences and people may say Ayton's a little better than Bagley, whatever, but they're on the same plane as far as talent is concerned. And again, like I said, NC State beat Arizona early in the year. I mean, they don't have any big men that's anywhere near the stratosphere of DeAndre Ayton. So again, none of these teams, you know, talent is talent, But the guys in this tournament with talent don't have any experience. So, I mean, that's one of the hard things about trying to predict what's going to happen, because the most talented teams are made up of freshmen and sophomores, and you don't know what's going, you don't know how they're going to play from game to game.
As my man KG said it when he won the title, anything's possible. So let's just clarify, who do you have for your in the championship, and who do you have again winning the title?
Well, I'll start with the Final Four. Out of the South region, I have Arizona coming out. Out of the East region, I have Villanova coming out. Out of the Midwest region, I have Michigan State. And out of the West, I have North Carolina. So I have North Carolina defeating Arizona to go to the championship game. I have Villanova defeating Michigan State. I have Michigan State defeating Villanova to go to the championship game. So I have North Carolina versus Michigan State in the championship game. And I have North Carolina being the first back-to-back champions since 91-92, and North Carolina going to the championship game three years in a row.
Experience-wise, I can see it, but nah, son, that ain't going to happen. I have Arizona for my Final Four. I have Arizona coming out of the South. I have Villanova coming out of the East. In the Midwest, I have Michigan State. And in the West, I have Michigan, which, anything can happen, I feel like, in that bracket, especially. I have Arizona playing Michigan. I have Arizona beating Michigan to advance, and I have Villanova beating Michigan State, and I'm going to go with the Villanova. Since we took it up top, as my man Chief like to say, we're going to keep it up top with Villanova, the Wildcats, beating Arizona in a very, very, very good national championship.
It's possible. It's possible. I guess my only retort to that is, I mean, how many times have you seen a freshman-laden team not only make it to the Final Four and then win it? I mean,
Carmelo Anthony with my Syracuse Orange men.
I mean, how long has Carmelo been in the NBA?
Okay. That's okay. I just wanted to let you know that my Orange men is in the tournament.
I mean, the last freshman-laden team that made it and won was actually Kentucky. That was that Kentucky team with Anthony Davis and Michael Kidd-Gilchrist and all those guys.
So who was the last team that went back to back? Like, come on, we can go that route.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, you're right. But I feel like these teams, this bracket, this tournament is ripe for a back to back, just because all the talent, the talent in this field is mostly young guys. And they're, you can't depend on them to come out and play great each game. So, we'll see what happens. We'll definitely see what happens. I definitely don't see North Carolina going out in the Sweet 16. But we'll see. We'll see. I mean, that's the fun of this whole thing. Trying to predict what's going to happen is crazy. And we're definitely going to, in our next episode, we'll definitely come back to this and see how we're doing.
Yeah. I have to say this is probably one of my favorite episodes, talking about basketball, talking about college basketball, one of my favorite subjects, man. This is good time of the year.
Definitely. So that is what we're looking at. So, Mad Dog, you have refresh me. Villanova as the national champion?
I got Villanova, son. You have Villanova as the national champion. Yeah.
I have the mighty, mighty University of North Carolina Tar Heels as the national champion. So we'll see what happens. I have Arizona, Villanova, Michigan State, and North Carolina in the Final Four. Now, who's your Final Four?
I got Villanova, Michigan State, Arizona, and Michigan.
Oh, man. So
yeah,
we're getting ready to rev up and check this tournament out. I also want to ask everyone that's listening, go on to our Facebook page. Let us know who your Final Four is. Let us know who your Final Four is, either on our Facebook page, that's Mad Dog Mike and the Chyef Show Facebook page, or you can go on to Anchor FM and you can actually record yourself and let us know who your Final Four is. We'll respond in the next episode, you know, and we'll kind of match what we, you know, what we've heard and what you've given us up with what we have. But we definitely want your feedback to see who you feel is going to make it to the Final Four and also your national champion. So please hit us up on Facebook, Mad Dog Mike and the Chyef. Or if you want to hit my Instagram, that's at Chyef Media. Mad Dog, what's your Instagram?
My Instagram is MDM promo. MDM underscore promo. Hit me up.
MDM underscore promo. Or again, you can go on Anchor FM and you can record yourself. Leave us your Final Four teams and your national championship team. So we're going to wrap it up with that and go ahead and get out of here. We definitely appreciate y'all for listening and just looking forward to this tournament, man. It's going to be crazy.
Definitely.
And also, I'm actually looking forward to the next episode, man, because we're definitely going to have to get into this NFL free agency, brother.
It's crazy.
So, ladies and gentlemen, please be on the lookout for the next episode as well, because we're going to delve deep into this NFL free agency.
Definitely. And this is Mad Dog Mike signing off, letting all my dogs know to remember, sports is another version of life's reality. L.A., L.A.
Ah, I hear you. And this is the Chyef letting you all know, in the words of my man 2 Chainz, if you woke up this morning, you winning. We out.
Good luck on them brackets.